And when
hi, I think I recognize everybody, but we may have a few visitors from that came in because of announcing this meeting kind of publicly. So welcome.
Join me.
I'm Linda Mayer. I'm vice president of this organization, and our co-presidents are sitting in the audience. And I'm also the co-chairman of the state committee that did this study and that is going to be putting on the consensus meetings on December 3rd. So hope all of you, plus each of you, bring two more people, please, to the consensus meeting so that we can have a really good discussion of this subject. And the best input into our thinking is going to come from today, from Dr. Kogan. And I do want to introduce him to you. I just learned some things about him. The first reason I know him is because in the course of our studies, we did a lot of research in the secondary literature on the subject. We came across his name a few times. And so towards the end of our study, we did a survey of all our experts to find out what they thought on different angles of primary elections. And some of them did not answer. But one of them did answer. And so we became more and more interested in the things he has to say. So I think you're going to find that you're interested in his things too. Here are some things I just this moment learned about him. He is assistant professor at The Ohio State University. He's a student of state and local politics. I think it's possible to say we're students of that too, perhaps not on the same level. Dr. Kogan is co-author of Paradise Plundered, Fiscal Crisis and Governance Failures in San Diego. So it's not only here, okay, which won the 2011 Best Book Award from the Urban Politics section of the American Political Science Association. So in 2010, Dr. Kogan was the recipient of the Alma H. Young Emerging Scholar Award from the Urban Affairs Association. His research has been published in the American Journal of Political Science, Electoral Studies, Legislative Studies Quarterly, Political Communication, Rutgers Law Journal, State Politics and Policy Quarterly, and Urban Affairs Review. Dr. Kogan serves on the editorial board of Urban Affairs and is affiliated with OSU's Center for the Study of Democracy, the Education, Governance, and Accountability Project, and the Translational Data Analytics at Ohio State. So we need to hear more from him and less from me.
So thank you guys for inviting me. I put together what I think is kind of the best information from the best research. And I have in my slides a lot of just pictures that I took from published work. I'm going to do my best to explain it, make sure it's clear. But if there's anything unclear, please interrupt with questions throughout. Don't wait until the end. I'm happy to answer questions as we go. And so this is not really the area that I study. So I've done my best to kind of present to you other people's work. So I don't have any sort of dog in the fight. But I think putting it together is very useful, at least for me, for thinking about what we know about primary elections and whether primary elections are really at the source of the problem that I think underlies a lot of the interest in primary elections. So the problem, I think one way of thinking about it is this. If you remember in 2009, President Obama was giving a speech before the joint session of Congress about his efforts to pass healthcare reform. And at one point he said, there's people out there that claim that under our plan, we will cover illegal immigrants, and that's just not true. And as he said this, there was a congressman, I think from South Carolina, who shouted, "You lie." And everybody was shocked, because it was just such a break of the usual decorum in the House and in Congress. And so it showed just kind of the level of acrimony, right, between the two parties. And I'm going to come back to this example of Joe Wilson, who was the congressman that yelled this, because in some ways I think it's going to speak to the origins of some of these issues. So this exchange between the president and Joe Wilson is symptomatic of a broader trend in American politics of growing polarization. And so this is a common measure that we use for how polarized Congress is, and it's basically the difference between the average average Democrat and the average Republican in their ideology. And you can see, so it reached a low in the 1930s, and it went up, and today we're in a period of historically high polarization. Congress has never been this polarized, right? The Democrats and Republicans have never been so far apart on so many issues. And a lot of people believe that primaries are at the root of this problem. And the argument kind of goes like this. I'm going to walk you through, as far as I understand the argument, that a lot of reformers made. So one underlying problem is, or symptom is the lack of competition in congressional elections. So these are congressional elections, and they're classified by Charlie Cook, who's a consultant, about the partisan composition of the voters. And today we have Congress where over 200 districts are safely Republican, and they're going to stay in Republican hands pretty much no matter what happens. About 175 districts are heavily Democratic, and only about 40 districts are really competitive, where there is really a reasonable chance of the district changing partisan hands. A lot of people claim this is redistricting, perhaps also because of just natural partisan self-sorting amongst the electorate. So in a place like Cleveland, in an area like Cleveland, it's going to be very hard to draw a district that's not overwhelmingly Democratic, right? But so the reality is that most districts are really not competitive. If you're an incumbent, you really have no risk of losing the general election in November. So perhaps you're worried more about the primary. Well, primaries are interesting in that turnout is really low. This is kind of turnout in Ohio elections going back to 2000. The green bars are the turnout in general elections as a percent of the registered voters. And the purplish bars is turnout in primaries. And one thing that's consistent in Ohio and elsewhere is that turnout in primaries is just much lower than turnout in general elections, right? A fraction of registered voters vote. Now, we know only about 60% of eligible voters are registered. So we're talking about, right, really less than 10% of the citizens deciding these elections in primaries. We also know that the kinds of people that vote in primaries are just different in a variety of dimensions. But one of them is that they have stronger beliefs, and they're more ideological. And so this is from a database that a vendor called Catalyst put together. So Catalyst is a big group that works with campaigns, and they put together a national voter file, and they purchased everything about you that they can get. So they purchase information from your credit card companies, they know what magazines you read, and based on information, they can classify with a pretty high degree of accuracy your ideology and your partisanship. And so this is their data on kind of the predicted ideology of Ohio voters. And you can see in general elections, the voters are different, especially the share of the voters who are moderate. And in primaries, most of the voters tend to be very ideological. And so when you put all these things together, one of the arguments, one of the claims, is that when you have districts that are so uncompetitive, they're going to be decided in the primaries. The people who are voting in these primaries are very ideological than the people who vote in November. And if the elections are going to be decided in the primaries, then the officials are going to be very worried, the elected officials are going to be very worried about not being extreme enough, right? They're worried of being so-called primary, right? Being challenged from the far right or the far left and losing the primary election. So they're most concerned about the primary, and perhaps that's driving polarization. So that's kind of the narrative, the common argument that a lot of reformers at least complain about. And so today I want to evaluate kind of each of these claims and give you evidence. And this is the best evidence I could find from political science research. And I'm going to compare kind of the myths to the realities. Again, most of this is not my own research. I have a few little pieces that I'll show you, but most of it's not my research. But it is the best research out there using kind of the cutting edge methods, cutting edge data. And then I'm going to give you an overview of one state's experience with primary reform, motivated very much by this kind of narrative, this kind of concern that primary elections are driving polarization, and maybe if you change the rules of primaries, maybe it'll make politics work better. And as you'll see, California's experience is not very free. So now, and by this point, I think my argument will become clear that I don't think primaries really have much to do with polarization, and I don't think changing primaries is going to make things a whole lot better. So then I'll talk about some alternative reforms that I think potentially might work, but I think many of you will find very troubling. Well, at least some. And I'll tell you about it and see why. So I laid out this argument about how primaries are leading to polarization, and that argument rests on a couple of assumptions. So one is that legislators who represent state districts are the most extreme members of Congress or the state legislators. That voters, when they're voting in elections, especially in primaries, are voting for candidates based on their issues, right, on their issue positions. They're choosing candidates who most agree with them on the issues. That candidates correctly perceive the issues that voters care about and what positions the voters take. And that finally, kind of the status quo that we have, this level of partisanship, is not what most voters want. That most voters want, and if they could, would reward bipartisanship. And I'm going to show you evidence that each of these assumptions is wrong. So none of these things, at least in American elections, seem to hold. And I'm going to walk you through kind of how this the kind of evidence that we have, and I'm happy to answer questions. I think a lot of this evidence is going to be troubling for how we think about democracy, but this is the best information that we have, and we shouldn't ignore it, just because we don't like it, I think. So the first myth is the idea that legislators who represent state districts are more extreme, right, which flows from this idea that if you're in a state district, all the competition is in the primary, and you're worried about getting primary. Empirically, that's not the case. In fact, the biggest gap in voting behavior, the biggest gap in partisanship, is between Democrats and Republicans that represent exactly the same districts, those 50-50 districts that are almost evenly divided. That's where we see the biggest gap in voting behavior in Congress and voting behavior in state legislatures. And I'll show you a picture of this from a recent paper. And as we go from a district that's barely Democratic to a district that's 80% Democratic, the legislators don't get all that much more liberal. And if we go on the other side, Republican legislators don't get that all that much more conservative. And so this is a picture. There's a lot going on here, so I'll explain it to you. So this is the share on the x-axis. This is the share of the vote in each district that is won by the Republican candidate. And so 50% is that key dividing line, right? If you win more than 50%, the Republican wins. If you win less than 50%, the Democrat wins. So that's where the votes is, the district flips. And on the y-axis is kind of this measure of voting behavior. Up here, this is in the U.S. House, this is in the U.S. Senate, this is in the state legislatures, lower house, and upper house, on the same scale. So the higher you go, the more conservative. The lower you go, the less conservative. All these dots are individual legislators. Pay attention to these black lines. This is kind of the average, right? And I think what you should see is that at 50%, this is the evenly divided district, right? It's a coin flip election where maybe it rains that day, or one voter gets in a car accident, right, and the election outcome changes. Even in that 50% district, there's a huge gap between the Democrat, the Republican selected and the Democrat in terms of their voting behavior. And as you see, as the district becomes more Republican or more Democratic, the voting behavior doesn't become all that much more extreme. So the biggest gap between Democrats and Republicans is really in these evenly divided districts. So it's not the case that the safest districts are the ones that elect the most extreme legislators in the House, in the Senate, or in the state legislatures. So it suggests, right, that it's not the case that being worried about the primary is what's driving these elections out necessarily, right? Because even in these districts where you should be really worried about the general election as well, and really worried, right, about making sure that you have not just the majority of your party, but the majority of your district, still in those districts, congressmen and legislators representing exactly the same constituents vote very differently in Congress with their party. Yeah. Any questions on this picture? Yes?
On this, the state legislature, the lower
yeah.
right corner, it looks like they actually become, your graph, if I'm
yeah.
reading it right, shows that they become just a bit more liberal.
A little bit more, yeah. So you're right, we do see it a little bit, but the difference between this and this, right, is much smaller than the difference between this. Mm-hmm. So when I say the biggest gap is really
the
biggest gap.
That.
Yeah, so
it
is
it looks
a little
like
bit,
a
yeah.
Trend.
Yeah, then there's definitely a little bit of a trend here. In the U.S. Senate, it's the opposite, right? The safer the state, the more conservative they become. But yeah, you can find some trends, but I think the big picture here is that, again, even if you made every district evenly divided and competitive, the Democrats that would elect would vote very differently in Congress than the Republicans would elect. Yes?
I don't know if I'm reading it right, but it looks like at the state level, Republicans and Democrats, they may have a wide gap between them, but when they vote, they pretty much vote the same. But that they seem to have a line going across there, which isn't true on the Senate and House.
Yeah, sort of gray line.
So yeah, granted, this is just kind of the individual points for individual legislators.
Yeah.
And so this is the average. So there are a lot of people up here, but there's also people spread out here. So when you average them together. Mm-hmm. But so I think it is the case that in the state level, Democrats and Republicans on average are closer together than in Congress. But I would say, you know, if you want our best prediction of what an average Democrat Republican would look like, is in fact this gray line, it's these black bars. Right. Right, that's kind of the average.
But they're still closer in the state than they are in the
They're
state.
A little bit closer. Mm-hmm. That's right. Which is interesting because state elections are actually kind of less competitive, right, than federal elections. And many of these districts, about a third, are completely uncontested. There is no general election opponent. And all the competition, if there is any, is in the primary. So another myth that's out there is that voters choose candidates in general elections, but also in primaries, based on the issues, right? That if you're an extreme voter, you're only going to vote for candidates who are extreme. And again, in this case, I think there is a little bit of that going on, but very few, very little of it. So let me give you an example from the 2000 election. Our best case scenario of seeing this idea that voters are going to vote for candidates based on issues. In 2000, there was an issue that was not very salient, which was Social Security reform. And it suddenly became very salient. So in the first debate and the third debate, George Bush and Al Gore argued very, very, very forcefully for their different visions for how to reform Social Security. It became a major campaign issue that until that point nobody was paying attention to. There was ads run, and in fact the majority of the ads in the election focused on Social Security. And so this was a great case, right, where voters really didn't know much about where the candidates stood. This issue became salient. They learned a lot by watching the debates, maybe as much by watching the ads. And so we should expect that voters who had a particular view on how Social Security should have changed their vote and adjust and vote for the candidate that best matches their position. And this is one of the ads. I don't know how the volume is in here, but this is one of the ads.
Government has made a commitment. Government has made a commitment. And you have made your plans. These promises will be honored.
George Bush's plan strengthens Social Security. It guarantees everyone at or near retirement every dollar of their benefits, no difference in Social Security. And the push plan gives younger workers the choice to put a small part of their Social Security in sound investments they control for higher return.
This generation will save Social Security.
So there's a lot of ads like this, right? So it's pretty clear where the candidates sit. And we have public opinion data from before Social Security became salient, so we know what people's opinions are on Social Security. We know who they have planned to vote for. Then this happens, they see the ads, and we have public opinion data after to see did they change their mind. So it turns out there was almost no voters who changed their mind based on what candidate to vote for based on their Social Security position. There was a lot of voters that changed their position on Social Security to match the position of the candidate they were voting for. So it seems like to the extent that we see this strong correlation between people are voting for and issue positions, people choose somebody to vote for and then change their own positions to match. There's another great example of this. This was an actual randomized experiment that was done in the States by a couple of political scientists. And so they convinced state legislators, I don't know how they did it, but they convinced them to randomly send out letters to constituents informing them where the legislators stood on an issue. And so what they did was, before these letters went out, they did a survey of all voters to figure out what do voters think about these issues. Then they had legislators send out letters describing their position on a variety of issues. They picked one at random. Then they did another survey, and they asked, well, do you approve or disapprove of the job that your state legislator is doing? And we would expect, again, that once voters got this letter and learned where their legislator stood, if they agreed with them, they should be approve of them. If they disagreed with the issues, they should disagree. So what do we find? The state didn't. So voters did not change their opinion about the legislator if they learned that the legislator took a very different position than them. Instead, the same thing. Voters changed their mind and adopted the position of the legislator. Right? When they learned, if their prior opinion differed, they got a letter saying, I'm your legislator, and this is how I'm going to vote on this bill, they changed their opinion on the bill. And what's interesting is this was a randomized experiment. So half of the voters got a letter that just said, hey, here's this bill, here's how I'm going to vote. And half got a very long letter saying, here's how I'm going to vote and why, with a very detailed explanation of reasoning. It didn't matter. It didn't matter whether there was any reasoning or not. If you just knew that the legislator was going to vote like this, you adopted, change your opinion. So yeah, it seems like voters are really not picking candidates based on positions. They're picking candidates first and then making sure their positions match that. Yes?
Actually, the interesting thing about that point is that I think it demonstrates how much our elected officials actually do exercise leadership.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yes, I agree completely. I think that's absolutely the case. And I made this argument, I think, to my colleagues that there's a lot of that you can't, a lot of us say, I have to do this because of my constituents or because of all these questions, but I think that's not the case.
Okay.
Yes?
So this isn't really a question. I hope this isn't out of line, but did you know that you left out a word in your first.
Yeah.
You need a not in
I know.
That.
Yeah.
Oh, you said it or
I'm
yeah.
sorry.
No.
Any other questions? Yes.
Well, I think sort of, I understand what you're saying, but like to me, like when I hear like people who vote on abortion rights, for example,
mm-hmm.
that seems to be more of a, I can't see that people would be as swayed than like an issue that they don't know that
right.
much about. So
yeah,
I
think you're absolutely right. Yeah, so like, there's really salient issues like same-sex marriage and abortion rights. On those issues, people's opinions are probably pretty fixed, although even on those issues, you'd be surprised.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at public opinion data, when President Obama came out in support of same-sex marriage, people's opinions changed. People that approved of the president, especially African Americans, suddenly became much more supportive of same-sex marriage. So even on those issues, again, probably you see smaller effects, but even there's huge leadership. There's huge kind of follow the leader effects, right?
You know, I think all of us do that to a certain degree. You know, that's what leadership is.
Right.
Is that what you said, Marianne?
I count on Brown
to know what he's talking about. You know, I think he knows what he's talking about.
Well, you know, I actually wanted to go back to the Social Security privatization because Bush then tried to do it in his second term, but he really met up with a lot of resistance
right.
to it. So do you think that maybe if he had tried to do it in his first term, he might have been more successful?
That's a good question. I mean, I think it was very organized opposition, right? It's not really clear that the opposition was representative of the
so
opinion of the district. So yes, there's definitely the ability to get organized and it has a big impact on legislators' perception of what the districts want. And we'll talk about it in a second as well. Yes?
Wouldn't it be, though, that statewide, maybe the people would follow their statewide leaders more and listen to them than they would on the national level with the president or something like that? Or is that across the board?
You know, I don't think there's enough research to know how they affect
this was only done on state.
This was done on state legislators.
Right.
In the previous study, there's a whole book, it's called Follow the Leader, that it had the example of Social Security, but it looks at writing presidential elections.
Mm-hmm.
And it goes all the way back to Ronald Reagan's election. There was an issue that became salient, and people didn't change their vote, they changed their on the issue to match.
Were the letters sent to people who supported them? Or
everybody, all the districts. And on average, people became more supportive. There could be some variation. Yes?
It doesn't sound to me as though this is saying good things about the leadership.
Yeah, I would agree.
I'll rely cheap.
And I'm going to come back to that point as well when I come back talk about the reforms that I think might help. Some of it has to do with strengthening leaders who I think are going to be less tempted to engage in kind of hardcore partisanship. And I'll come back in a second. So leadership is definitely important.
I was just going to say, I don't think we like this data, so we're trying to find
rationale. And I'm happy to I have, if you want to read the actual studies from which all this is done, I'm happy to share those with you and just let you know. So another, I think, big problem is that for the story about candidates adjusting their, becoming more extreme to match what the voters want, we're assuming that they actually know what their voters want, right? What their primary electorate wants, what their districts want. And again, there's really not a lot of evidence to say that that's the case. And I think this is a really complicated picture, so I'm going to walk you through it. So these are, this is surveys that was done of voters to figure out what percent of voters in each district support universal health care. And there's a survey of candidates running in those districts to say, what percent of the voters in this district do you think support universal health care? The same thing, it's a survey of voters for their support of same-sex marriage, and a survey of state legislative candidates in these same districts asking, what do you think the voters think? And so on the x-axis, this is what the voters want. On the y-axis, it's what the legislators think the voters want, or the candidates. So some of these are incumbents, some of these are opponents. And if they were exactly right, all the dots should be on these 45-degree lines, right? So there's a lot of stuff on the slide, but I would focus on these lines. So this is the average Republican candidate. This is the average Democratic candidate. And the same thing, this is the average Republican candidate. This is the average Democratic candidate. And so, on average, you see it's an upward sloping line, which means the more supportive the district is, the more supportive the candidates perceive the district to be, so that's a good thing. But what's troubling is this gap, right? At every level of constituent support, Democrats and Republicans, looking at exactly the same district, running the same district, perceive voters to have different preferences, right? The Democrats think that voters are more supportive, and the Republicans think that voters are less supportive. Again, so these are the same districts, these are the same voters. So the candidates looking at these districts, based on their interactions, based on the polling data they have, in their mind, have very different beliefs about what the voters want in the districts.
It's their perspective.
It's their perspective, and we'll talk a little bit about where that's
an exercise in selective perception.
It's maybe selective perception. It's also, when you think about it, if you're a candidate, it's really hard to know, right? You won an election with 60% of the vote. What does that mean? Does that mean that 60% of people agree with you on the issues? If they're not voting against the issues, not necessarily.
Maybe you only talk with people
right?
who agree with you.
And that's true.
And
so
you watch the news that agrees with you.
That's absolutely true. And so there's also interesting research about who contacts legislators. So we know that candidates really care about the calls and letters they get. Not necessarily because they think it's representative of their district, but because these are the people that care enough about this issue,
right.
And these are probably people that are going to vote based on that issue. And one thing that we see is that constituents are much more likely to contact legislators when they're from their party, right? So they're only hearing from half of their electorate, and it's usually from people that agree with them that reinforce their viewpoints. I think that's a big part of the story as well. So finally, maybe most controversial, most depressingly, is there's this idea that most voters hate the system that we have, they hate the partisanship, and they really want, and if they could, if they had the opportunity, they would reward bipartisanship. It's partly true. Voters do say they want more bipartisanship. But if you really dig deeper into the data, they really don't reward it. They don't reward candidates that give them more bipartisanship. And there's a series of experiments, and I'm going to show you one of them, that I think speaks to this really well. So this was in a survey, and it was basically an experiment embedded in a survey where voters were told about an issue. In fact, this was all made up. Voters didn't know this was made up. But they were told that President Obama and the Republican leadership of the House are currently negotiating on how much spending to cut from NASA in 2013. In 2012, NASA's budget was approximately $19 billion. Then they were told that President Obama and the Democrats proposed cutting $200 million from NASA. Speaker Boehner and the Republicans proposed cutting $400 million. And they said, well, suppose that ultimately they agree on this amount. And this was varied at random. So sometimes it was $200 million, which is what the Democrats wanted. Sometimes it was $400 million, which is what the Republicans wanted. And sometimes it was in between, it was $300 million. And they were asked, what would you think of this compromise, right? Or this final resolution? So it could be, right, what the Democrats want, what the Republicans want, or some bipartisan compromise. So what's interesting is, first, So this shows kind of how bipartisan they think the outcome is. And so, maybe encouragingly, the bipartisan compromise that's in the middle is perceived as being more bipartisan than everything else. What's maybe more concerning is that the outcome that gets your party what they want is seen as being more bipartisan than the outcome that gets the opposite party what they want, which is kind of hard to understand. And that's even true about amongst voters who say they want bipartisanship, right? Who say they value bipartisanship. What's more worrying is that when you ask them about how much they would support this legislation, they would much more likely support their own party getting exactly what they want than they would a bipartisan compromise. Even amongst people who say they want bipartisan compromise in Congress. And there's just a series of experiments like this, including telling people this is how your legislator votes and randomly varying that. Sometimes they're a hardline partisan, sometimes they're bipartisan that works with the other party. And most voters, most of the time, will prefer the hardline partisan if they know that they're a partisan versus a bipartisan. So they don't reward bipartisanship. And they're not happy with bipartisan outcomes, right? They want their party to win. Even if they say they want bipartisanship, how can that be? Well, get a lot of evidence showing that when voters say they want more bipartisanship, they usually mean they want the other party to compromise with their party and get what they want, right? And when their party compromises, they really don't reward that. In fact, they punish incumbents for doing so, right? For giving in to the opposite party. So why is this the case? I think it's not because voters are really ideological, because they really care, right, how much is cut from NASA, right? Most voters don't care. But for them, this is kind of like sports, right? These are teams, and they're rooting for their team, right? This is a very emotional way of thinking about politics. It's an identity, right? Your partisanship is part of your identity. It's not a series of issues or a series of public policies. And so everybody's rooting for their side. And they're looking for that emotional reward. They're not looking for actual policies. So it's kind of like college football, right? Root for the Buckeyes, not because you have some belief about the Buckeyes having the best strategy or believing in their defense. It's because, right, just root for the Buckeyes. And so when there's evidence of this, there's an article recently that came out called Fear and Loathing Across Party Lines. Yeah, that looks at how much people in their day-to-day lives hate the other party. Just in their day-to-day, not in politics, but just in everyday social interactions. And the experiment was this. They would ask people to evaluate applicants for college scholarships. And they gave information about their name, kind of their community involvement, extracurricular activities. And they randomly varied. Right, they have a very kind of subtle cue about their partisanship. So they said, oh, they were the president of the Young Republicans, or they were the president of the Young Democrats. And then there's everything, you know, they varied the GPA. And they wanted to see, you know, if you tell people a little bit about what party these students are, how are a representative sample of voters, how are they going to decide who gets a scholarship? And when the candidates are equally qualified, Republicans give the scholarship to the Republican student 70% of the time. Democrats give it to the Republican student less than a quarter of the time. When the Republican student is more qualified, still the same thing. Democrats still won't give the Republican student the scholarship. And vice versa, when the Democratic student is more qualified, the Republicans still won't give the scholarship to the Democratic student. And there you can see this in a variety of issues. I don't know if I have the time. I guess I don't have that. One of the things that we've asked people a lot going back to the 1970s is, how would you feel if a member of your family or your child married a member of the opposite party? And the vast majority of voters would say they would be very, very disappointed. Right? So there's something emotional, right, about our relationship to our parties. And it's partly as a result that we don't like to see the other party win. Right? We don't want to see our party give in. And that's completely separate from, right, from primaries, from who runs the primaries and who votes in primaries. And that's true for most voters. So I think, given this reality, given the incentives that legislators face, given the incentives that voters create, I think it's unlikely that just changing party for our primary rules is going to really change polarization all that much. And I'm going to show you some evidence of that from California, which did try to change primaries to get more bipartisanship. Yes?
Maybe you're going to get there eventually, but I'm curious about where this puts independence.
So I would say, and I'll get to this in a little bit, Independents are different. So independents do reward bipartisanship, but independents are not very engaged. They don't pay attention to politics. Mm-hmm. And there's very, very few of them. So there's many people who claim they're independents, but they're really just closet partisans. If you look at the voting behavior, 90% of the time they vote for the same party over and over again. And they're just as loyal to their party as kind of real partisans. So only about 10% of voters are true independents in the sense that they really don't have a pre-standing commitment. And they're not engaged, and they're really not educated about politics. They have no idea what's going on. They rarely vote. And that's probably why they're so disconnected. That's why they don't really care.
What's the independence?
Right. Well, so California, again, motivated by some of these same concerns, California is one of the most polarized states in the country at the state legislative level. They thought, well, maybe if we change primaries, that would make the problem better. So up until 2010, California had semi-closed primaries. So you have to be, you have to register as a party member under Ohio registration as partisan. You can be a Democrat, Republican, or you can be what's called a declined to state, so you don't declare party affiliation. But on election day, if you want to vote in a primary, you can choose that party ballot, but then you only have to vote in that party's primary. And in 2010, there was a reform passed that created this nonpartisan top two primary. And so after 2010, all the candidates show up on the same ballot. There could be multiple Democrats, multiple Republicans, and the top two vote getters, regardless of party, move on to the November election. And everybody sees the same ballot, Democrats, Republicans, and independents. And then the top two vote getters advance. So one question is, right, did this increase turnout in primaries? Did independent voters suddenly say, I feel more included, I want to participate? And the answer is no. So this is turnout in California primaries going back 100 years. As you see, they start going down. This is when the reform is passed, and they continue going down. Any huge increase in turnout in the primaries. Is there a change in who's voting in the primaries? So these are the two primaries before the reform. These are the two primaries after the reform. And this is actually partisan registration of all voters. And you can see that independents, who decline to say preference, rarely vote in primaries before the reform, but they don't start voting in the primaries after the reform either. And I think at this point that I made, that they're independent for a reason. They really don't care, right? They didn't vote before because it was really hard to get the party ballot. It was because they really don't care that much about politics. And the people that vote in these low salience, low turnout elections are the people that really care. So just changing the rules of who gets to vote isn't going to change that. Question? Or,
it did change one thing. It did increase the number of other parties.
It did a little bit, although, as we'll see in a second, it may have increased the turnout amongst other party registrants in the primaries. It massively decreased the number of third-party candidates that actually made it to the November ballot. And I'll talk about that in a second.
Yeah.
So why did the turnout increase in independents? Well, as I said, they're just far less interested in informing about politics. And it was that lack of interest that was really the primary reason why they weren't voting in the primaries before. It wasn't the fact that the primaries were semi-closed instead of open. Yes?
If you go back a few slides, you don't actually have to do that.
Yes.
One more. It's about 1982, it looks like, that the crash really starts.
Mm-hmm.
And are political scientists, is there any ideas as to why it happened then so precipitously? What happened about 1982 that voters suddenly disengaged?
It's a good question.
You know what happened then?
No.
One thing that we do know.
It's starting to go down and it goes up for Reagan.
The best predictor of turnout in primaries is how competitive the primary is. So this time around, there was at least a perception that California, that the presidential election wasn't going to be decided until after the California primary in June. And turnout was way up. Not because of the top two systems, just because it actually mattered. And the outcome wasn't obvious. Yeah. Again, at the highest level office. The state legislative race is a lot of more always competitive, right, in the primaries. But that's not what everybody pays attention to. It's the president and the governor. Yes.
So if you're arguing that competitive primaries increase turnout, why wouldn't competitive general elections increase turnout?
And they do, they absolutely do.
And so why wouldn't a top two create more competitive general elections?
Well, we'll look at that in a second. So they do sometimes, but they don't necessarily lead to the election of more moderate members. So I'll show you some evidence on this.
Extreme risk.
So ahead of the 2012 elections, it was the first election where the top two system was in place. There was a couple of political scientists at UC Berkeley that did a survey of voters who were about to vote. This was 2 weeks before the primary. And they asked them to place candidates on the left-right ideological scale, figure out who is the more moderate of the two or three or four candidates running, right, in these primaries. Because we, right, part of the argument is if you make primaries open, people will vote and moderate candidates will win because the independents will turn out. Well, it turns out that people have no idea where the candidates are, right? So this on the x-axis is the true candidate ideology, right? How extreme they are. And on the y-axis is where voters perceive the candidates to be. And one thing that you should see is it's a straight line, right? Regardless of how extreme or moderate the candidate is, the voters perceive it to be exactly the same. They have no idea. They can't tell apart. If you see, give them two Democrats, they can't figure out which one is the moderate one, right? Which is necessary, right? If you want primaries to really serve as a mechanism for electing moderates. If voters don't know who the moderate is, that's not going to happen. So all the Democrats they thought was just the average Democrat. All the Republicans they thought was the average Republican, regardless of which actual Republican was running, and regardless of which was two. So we have in California, so one of the consequences is that in a lot of these really lopsided districts, the candidates that made it past the primary were from the same party. So you did have, in the November election, one moderate and one more extreme candidate running. It also meant that there was far fewer third-party candidates running because they never made it past the primary. We think, right, that in November when turnout is up and all the independents are voting, right, surely then the moderate will win, right, because all the independents will vote for them and all the voters from the other party will vote for them. Well, it turns out that the moderate candidate only won 50% of the time. Half the time, the most more extreme candidate won anyway, running against the same party opponent in November when the electorate was much more moderate. Probably because, again, voters really had a hard time figuring out who the moderate was. As I said, the number of third-party candidates appearing on the ballots went down dramatically. So this is the distribution of candidates. This is the Republicans. These are the Democrats by their ideology. And so the higher this graph, the more candidates there are here. So the further you go this way, the more liberal they are. The further you go this way, the more conservative they are. And this is in 2010 before the reform. This is in 2012 after the reform. These are the people who got elected into office. And you should see that there's no moderation, right? The people that got elected, based on their voting behavior, are not any more moderate. This is the voters in California. And you can see the Democrats are pretty liberal. The Republicans are pretty conservative. And the decline of state independents are in the middle. And they're still not represented, right? This is where the independents are. There's no candidates actually elected with that same ideology here. And this is what you see nationally. This is another study that looked at, is there a relationship between the kind of primary that a state uses and the part of the ideology and the polarization of people elected to Congress or the state legislature. And I think one thing you should see, this is the pure close. This is the most restrictive, where you have to be registered with that party to vote and very polarized. This is the pure open primary, where anybody can vote. This is nonpartisan in California, the top two model. And even there, right, the gap between the average Republican gets elected and the average Democrat is as large as the gap in the pure and closed states. So empirically, the type of primary that states use doesn't predict how ideological, how polarized the candidates who are elected are. Yes?
In California, after the reform, how was voter turnout at the
In November?
In November. I would think it would go down.
That's a good question. It's hard to compare because again, competitiveness of the elections has a big effect at the gubernatorial and presidential level. And so
but I would think that the election from the primary, the two candidates would be so similar
in some districts, but in the districts where you have two people from the same party, usually that election is a cakewalk, right? The Republican's going to win with 90% of the vote. When there's two Republicans, they spent a lot of money, right? Because they thought they at least had a chance. And we know that the more you spend, the the higher the turnout, because the more engagement will become in the election. So probably in some districts that turnout went up in November. But that's a good question. I don't have the data for the whole state. So I think this suggests again, primaries probably are not going to do all that much, changing primaries to fix this problem. So what can we do to reduce polarization? Because I think there is clearly a disconnect between the policies that elected officials think their constituents want and the policies that they actually want. And I would say the best thing that you can do is find some way to give legislators better information about what their constituents want. And there is evidence that if you give them information about what their constituents want, they do change their behavior in some cases in a more moderate direction. So this is the one piece of research that's actually mine. And this compares polarization in the Ohio House of Representatives in the 2010 and 11 session. So this is, ignoring the dash lines for a second, this is kind of the distribution of Democrats, the gray lines of distribution of Republicans, and they're polarized, right? This is the average of Republicans, the average Democrat. And this was the section in which SB5, the collective bargaining reform, was passed. And there was a big referendum, and it went down in defeat almost across the whole state. So you had a lot of Republicans who were elected by huge margins whose voters voted down this conservative policy. And one of the things I find is that after the election, in the last half of that legislative session, the Republicans become more moderate because they realize, wait a second, we totally misread what our constituents wanted, right? So there was this big shock, informational shock. There was this referendum, and they updated their beliefs about what their constituents want. There's another study. This is a really ugly picture, but I'll walk you through it. This is from New Mexico. And New Mexico, about 10 years ago, had a big windfall, tax windfall, because of oil extraction. And so the government called a special session and said, we have a couple hundred million dollars to spend. Here's how I want to spend it. And so this was an issue that wasn't on the agenda before. Legislators had no idea what their constituents wanted. And a couple of political scientists, they actually went out and they did surveys, not just in the state, but district by district. So they actually figured out how supportive were voters of the governor's proposal. And then they randomly divided the legislators in half. And at half, they actually sent them the results and said, hey, we just did a poll in your district. And this is what your voters think about the governor's proposal. And so this is on the x-axis, the percent of voters favoring the governor's spending proposal. And this is the treatment group. This is the people who got the letter with the poll results. And you can see the more supportive their district was, the more likely they were to vote for the governor's proposal, right? So we had very good representation. Once they knew what their voters wanted, they voted in line. This is the people that never got the letters. And so and you can see there's kind of this weird line, but one thing you should note is that legislators from districts where the constituents absolutely hated the governor's proposal, and those where the constituents loved it, voted exactly the same way. Because they had no idea, right? They didn't know what the constituents wanted. So just giving this information, running a survey, and giving them the results, had this big effect on voting behavior. Second, more controversial, I think, for this audience, I think that one of the solutions is more money in politics. And here's why. We know that small donors are much more ideologically extreme than large donors. So Joe Wilson, who yelled, you lied in Congress, the next 28 hours after yelling that and getting all this media attention, got a massive influx of small donor donations. So one of the consequences of all the campaign finance reforms is that amplifies the influence of small donors who are just much more ideological. And so this is from the FEC. This is the kind of candidates that different groups of donors give money to. So these are the super liberal Democrats, these are the super conservative Republicans, and you can see the most conservative candidates get the most money from small donors. If you look at who the big donors are giving, the biggest donors, they're much more moderate. They tend to give money to more moderate candidates. So if you want more moderation, I think allowing big donors to play a bigger role will probably achieve that. And I would argue, especially if you channel that money through parties, through leaders. Because party leaders really care about winning elections. They realize that potentially nominating somebody extreme would not be good for the party. And so one of the ways to do this is to allow big donors to give more, but channel that through parties, right? Give party leaders more influence over how that money is spent. And it's probably the case that party leaders will try to channel that money to help more moderate candidates, especially in the primaries. And I think make it harder to run in primaries and give more gatekeeping power to parties, right? Allow parties to have a bigger say, right, over who gets to run, to help the party select the candidates win. And those party selected candidates are probably going to be more moderate than the kind of the outsiders who are running against them. Yes?
Wasn't the recent Republican primary, wasn't there a lot of big money at the very beginning, and you ended up with a very outcome than what
so
it just.
Maybe not. So there was a lot of big money in the beginning. It all went to Jeb Bush, who was probably one of the most moderate. He didn't win. Right? So money's not sufficient to win necessarily. But I think it shows you, right, that the big donors, they favored the moderate candidate. Donald Trump got a lot of small donations, right? A lot, much more than Hillary Clinton did. So small donors are really strange, right? They have very extreme preferences. So it doesn't mean that giving candidates money is necessarily going to guarantee a victory. Right? Jeb Bush lost despite having, you know, almost $200 million. But, right, it does show that anything we can do to kind of give more influence to the people that were giving the money will probably lead to the election of more moderate candidates. Now, there might be trade-offs, right?
Yeah.
Moderation is not the only thing we care about. Lack of partisanship is not the only thing we care about, right? Jeb Bush was probably, in terms of the policies he adopted, there would be policies that were going to be very favorable to big donors. So there'd be that trade-off. But, yes?
Are you saying, so in general, that it's your belief that policies which strengthen political parties are preferable to policies that weaken political parties?
I think policies that strengthen party organizations and party leaders, I think, are preferable. Because party leaders, at the end of the day, they want to win. They want a majority, right? They want a majority. Mm-hmm. And even though they have policies they want to adopt, they want to keep that majority, right? Because if you lose the majority, your policy can be reversed.
So big contributions to candidates directly or to parties?
I think to parties, yeah. You want to give directly
to
candidates,
parties,
yeah.
Directly are to be encouraged, and
that's my view.
Dark money, yeah. Which goes to
right.
Causes and things.
Right. So there's still
just
exactly, rich. And so there's still a lot of big money spending, right? It's run through super PACs that are only loosely separated from the candidates. But the more but that arose because of campaign finance reform, right? Before campaign finance reform, there was tons of corporate money, right? Before 2001, there was tons of corporate money in elections. A lot of it was funded, channeled through the parties, through soft money. A lot of it was channeled directly. Partly because those channels were eliminated, that money that is now channeled through kind of these independent organs. The soft money was completely banned, right? The existing contributions on hard money were retained. Yes?
So are you looking to more of a pre-Buckley model than what we currently have today?
No, I would say a pre-Bickra model, but the Bipartisan Campaign Reform Act of 2001, the McCain-Feingold.
Okay.
Right? So after Buckley, before 2001, there was kind of the regulated money, and there was a lot of unregulated money that was funneled through the parties, because parties were kind of a big loop.
Yeah.
And that gave party leaders a lot of influence,
mm-hmm.
and I think
but
that helped restrain some of those.
Wasn't a part of the problem from a Democratic standpoint the non-disclosure of that money?
If it was funneled through the parties, and the parties still disclosed it, there was a lot of ways to still spend it without disclosure, right? So corporations and big donors could buy issue advocacy ads that mentioned candidates by name, but didn't say vote for or against them, and that was completely no disclosure required.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I mean, and there's gonna be trade-offs, right? There's gonna be trade-offs. And I would say you have to kind of pick your poison, right? If you're really worried about polarization, then you might have to be willing to accept more influence from big money donors.
Mm-hmm.
And if you really worry about big money donors, you might have to accept really polarized politics, right? And I think one of the big lessons is that there's these trade-offs that we have to acknowledge. And I think one of the reasons why politics has gotten so polarized is because campaign finance reform did sort of work and it strengthened the voice of these small donors.
Yes, but do you think that coupling that with full disclosure and getting rid of like this super PAC blockade would be a better compromise, and that you would be still funneling it through the party model, but if you had to know where that money was coming from?
Probably. I mean, the super PACs have to disclose, right? The super PACs have to disclose. It's the 501c4s that don't, right? That's where the dark money is.
Yeah.
Super PACs are still governed by the usual disclosure requirements?
Not completely. There's disclosure in how you bundle. It's not a fully transparent model.
Well, yeah, that's true. Okay.
Will you talk a little bit about municipal elections? We live in Northeast Ohio, which is dominated by one party, and the primary generally picks the winner in November, and the winner of the primary generally is the candidate supported by the party. So how do you end up with better elections and more competitive elections in November?
When you say candidates that win the primary in November, most municipalities have nonpartisan elections, right? So people still figure out the party. But it's kind of this, most at the local level, I think 80% across the country, and most of the elections in Ohio, aside from the county elections, are nonpartisan. So it's kind of the top two model, right? It's certainly the case that, again, usually people figure out who the party affiliations and the candidate that represents the dominant party wins. But, I'm not sure. I haven't thought carefully enough to answer your question. I would say I'm not sure that more competitive elections are necessarily they're going to come with trade-offs as well, right? Because more competitive elections are going to be much more expensive elections, right? And that's going to create trade-offs as well in terms of reliance on big donors and things like that. So I don't have a good answer for you on municipal or local elections, but I don't think polarization is a huge problem, right, in local government.
No, I'm not arguing polarization.
Right. Yes.
Our research found that most municipalities in Ohio, in their local elections, and almost all counties, I think 86 out of 88, they all use the state's default system of primary elections, which are semi-closed parties.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's only charter municipalities that are able to choose what kind of election. Half of them have nonpartisan,
mm-hmm.
and half of them stick with the state default.
Interesting.
So
okay.
It's really not—it's not the case.
Interesting. Okay.
That so many, maybe the ones we live in.
Mm-hmm.
I think most of us, many of us here, have nonpartisan local primaries.
Right.
But so that's
interesting. That's good to know.
So because some of us, one of the things we're hoping to come out of this study.
Yeah.
Is what if we sit on or testify to a charter review commission at some time, and one of the questions is, should we change our primary election system?
Well, I would say,
do you have any thoughts on that?
I would say, if the objective is to increase turnout in local elections, the best way to do that is change the timing to correspond with federal elections. So make it immediate elections. If you look nationally, the biggest predictor of turnout in local elections is timing. Like when it's presidential election.
The odd numbered years.
Yeah, so that's the lowest turnout, is odd numbered years.
And your statistics don't show anything from the municipal, but the turnout figures are much worse.
Correct, yeah.
They're down around 12%.
Right. I would say, again, if you want high turnout, you move to even year elections. Because there's trade-offs, right?
Well,
because voters' attention is going to be divided now.
Mm-hmm.
Advertising is going to be much more expensive because now you're competing with the presidential candidates potentially for airtime. So it's going to come with trade-offs, but ultimately what you care most about is turnout. Timing is the most important predictor of turnout in local elections. Yes?
I'm on the committee, and I interviewed two county board of elections.
Mm-hmm.
And I asked them the question, in your experience, what is the most influential thing on the turnout? And they both said the issue, not the candidates, the issues that's on the ballot.
If
you have a school levy on your ballot, you're going to have a much bigger turnout than if there's no issue.
Yeah.
And I thought that was a very interesting.
It's a good hypothesis. I don't have any data to test it. I'm not sure if that's true or not, but that's certainly something that the data is out there, right? That one could look at.
And they both have long years of experience and said, what makes the difference?
Yes.
What about ranked voting? Do you have any statistics on that?
I do. So I have some extra slides.
What's
your on ranked choice voting, instant runoff voting.
Yeah.
So one of the big appeals of instant runoff voting, right, is that you can have it all in one day on a high turnout election, right? So maybe more representative. So this is actually another area where I have my own work that I present to you. And so one of the problems with ranked choice voting is that it requires much more of the voters, right? Instead of knowing one candidate you want to vote for, now you have to have a rank ordering. And we know that voters really don't have, right, that much, they don't know that much about politics. They might know who they like the most, but getting them to rank order everybody is not realistic in most cases. And that's going to be a problem, this is it should be exhausted, because there's kind of this problem with ranked choice voting that nobody talks about, which is ballot exhaustion. And so the idea is that if you vote for somebody, and then you don't rank everybody else, and your candidate is eliminated, your ballot's thrown out. Your ballot has nothing back. So we did have a paper we published a couple of years ago, and something's getting a lot of attention because of the main the voting. You got a call from a lot of national journalists. So we looked at the primarily two local elections. So we collected ballot images. We got 600,000 actual pictures of ballots. And we could see, right, what was going on with those ballots. So three of them are in California. One is in Washington, Pierce County, Washington. And you see that across the board, a massive number of ballots were just thrown out. Right? They're excluded before the final round of redistribution because voters didn't rank enough candidates. Between 10% in San Francisco, where elections are really competitive, and there's like 20 candidates running, right? You're not going to rank all 20. A third of the ballots get thrown out. One of the consequences is that in all these elections, the winner never wins a majority of the votes that were cast because of the exhaustion. So I think this is a big problem with ranked choice voting is the fact that very few voters are going to be able to rank all the candidates, and those who don't potentially get their ballot thrown out. And we really don't know who that is going to be. Is it going to be the more moderate voters, the more extreme voters, right? That's going to create a lot of unintended consequences. And I think, so there's not a lot of research on ranked choice voting. I think after Maine puts in their model, we'll have a lot more data. We can actually see what are the actual factual consequences. But I'm very concerned about this exhaustion problem and the potential just for undermining, right, faith in democracy, because candidates, we get elected without a majority, right? Some consequences. I don't know what those consequences are, but potentially serious consequences. Yes?
I'm not sure our audience knows this, but we found out at our National League's convention that the League of Women Voters of the state of Maine was the proponent. Mm-hmm. They did the petition. Mm-hmm. They got it on the ballot. Mm-hmm. They collected the coalition that put it across. Mm-hmm.
And
it won by 52%.
Right.
So, there's pressure on us to get onto this bandwagon. Mm-hmm. So it's interesting.
So, yeah, I mean, it could be good.
What are some advantages?
Well, I mean, one of the claimed advantages is that it caused it. Encourages candidates to be more inclusive in how they campaign because they want to get the second choice votes of the other candidates. Again, there's still no data, right? There's a handful of local governments that use this across the country. So everything we have is pretty much anecdote. There could be all these benefits. It could be an improvement. It could be all these unintended consequences. And I think it's hard to know in advance until we actually have a state that implements this on a large scale like Maine, where we can actually study it and see, does it change the way campaigns are run? Does it change, right, turnout? Does it change who wins? It may change things for the positive, but again, it could also make things, at least, if not worse, it could create other problems that offset the current problems. So I'm not against ranked choice voting, I'm just concerned about how little we know about it.
The people in attendance understand a little something about mm-hmm. it.
Right. Yes?
Are you saying that when they have the ranking system, if there are five candidates, they have to rank all five?
Yes.
They can't just take the top three?
You could, but if those top three are the not the candidates that have the most votes, your ballot's thrown out, right? Because there's no way to redistribute your votes to after those candidates get eliminated. So yeah, so the interesting about each of these four cases, partly because of the technological problems, all these local governments use the same technology, which limits you to three choices, regardless of how many candidates are running. You can only rank your top three. Now, is that part of the problem? So we can't look at it systematically. There is Portland, Maine, that has used ranked choice voting, and they basically use handwritten ballots, and the people can make as many as they want, and even there, ballot exhaustion rates are 20%. Right? Because even if you can rank up to 10, no, very few voters are going to actually have a preference ordering over all 10 candidates, right? And if they don't, potentially, there's some chance that their ballot will get thrown out before the final round of
voting for judges.
Could
you repeat what exhaustion means?
Exhaustion just means that you cast a ballot, but all the candidates you ranked got eliminated before the final round. And so now, if all the candidates you ranked are no longer in the running, your ballot is pretty much meaningless. They take it out, and it doesn't count for anything. So it doesn't have any influence on the final outcome.
It's like March Madness.
It depends. I mean, if you only voted for one candidate, and that candidate didn't make the first round, it could get.
No, I thought even before the first round.
No. It just means you have no influence on the final, that final head-to-head matchup that determines, and the last, that determines who wins the day. Yes?
You know, when you mentioned, I thought I understood exhaustion, and I didn't. I interpreted exhaustion like, good grief, I have to think about it.
Voter exhaustion.
But I, which brings up my point, I think, with the long view, what the problem really is the voter.
Yes.
I mean, we need to teach critical thinking, we need to teach civics. I think our new First Lady probably doesn't know beans about American history.
Our First Lady? President.
Certainly the case, but the voters aren't going to change, right? Voters are always like this, and they're always like this. Because the incentive just isn't there, right? Your vote is only pivotal if it's a tie election, right? And if your vote's not pivotal, why would we spend time researching this instead of watching football and drinking beer?
Well, we lived, in a different culture for a few years, and 90% voted.
Yeah.
90% of the populace voted.
Yeah. And where?
Or
Germany.
The League sent some of us to foreign countries way back when they had money. and I was in Zimbabwe, and I was embarrassed because this was back in 1999. Their voter turnout was so much better than in our country.
I mean, part of it is also structural, right? A lot of these countries don't require you to re-register to vote for the election, right? So there's a lot of election rules.
There. They vote on Sunday.
Right. Yeah, we can run
the
Yes.
Well, you know, the other thing that I think that, in a way, I think it's the voter, but when we were at National, we heard, it was Linda Lake that came to talk to us about what motivates voters to turn out. And I think one of our comments was that if you really want to instill someone to be a long-term voter, you sort of have to create kind of an identity of being a voter. And I think, and I've heard this expressed elsewhere, is that if you want people to be voters, you want people to be civically engaged.
Sure.
And if they're civically engaged, they're probably more likely to understand compromise, they're more likely to understand, the other, they might be more likely to understand that there are other points of view and that type of thing. So it really, I think, boils down to a cultural problem, which probably starts in our schools. I mean, in our
or even younger. So I agree with a lot of that. I do think I'd be careful because the more engaged people get, the more they understand the issues, I think also the more extreme they'll get, right? Because the more passionately they'll feel about the issues, then I'm not sure that's going to make them more willing to compromise compared to a way that doesn't care very much so for them.
She's arguing for like a wholesale change, not a like, let's just educate people on ideas. It's much more fundamental than that. We don't have kids now aren't required when they go to college, that colleges don't require a government class any longer for admission. It's those kind of problems that have nothing to do with partisan and has to do with an educating of our electorate that we have massively failed on in the past 50 years.
I would say I teach political science students at Ohio State, so they're good students and they're really interested in politics because they take political science classes. Even the vast majority of them don't pay any attention to politics. They're not very low. If you ask them what party controls the House of Representatives, a significant number of them won't know, right? Wow. And so if you get if political science students are who are inherently interested in political science, right? I mean, I think the practical limits to how far, even in an ideal world, right, we can get kind of the mass voters educated. Yes?
Okay, but the problem is our schools. It absolutely, positively is, if you have charter schools and you have homeschooling, and you have people teaching children whatever they think is right, you know, that untruthiness that's out there, that comes from schools were formed so that we had a common bond and a common outlook and a common whatever
understanding
with 53 TV stations and people doing whatever they want to do. We don't have that anymore, and our schools, we need it, and our schools aren't giving it to us, so education is the ruin of this country.
I wanted to get back to what we're going to talk about. But when there's a, some states have runoffs for certain elections, and
we don't do that.
But if there's runoffs, now what if we did ranked choice voting with a runoff, but that afterwards, you know, of the top two?
That's top two.
Or some other way, but then there's more expense to each time you have a election.
Yeah, I think timing is really important. So if you look at places like Louisiana that have runoffs, so they have the actual election on November and they have a runoff later, turnout in the runoff is
terrible.
So San Francisco, one of the reasons why they went to the ranked choice voting was they used to have runoffs, and the runoff was in December, and turnout was like 10%
in that runoff.
Because if it doesn't coincide with the really salient race, No one's gonna turn out. And
if
people do are probably gonna be not as great representatives.
Well, I don't see any answer to these problems.
He tried.
If you can find mechanisms to give legislators information about what the constituents want, I think with technology that's out there, I think there are possibilities to do this. I mean, it's not letting people write to the legislators, because that's gonna be again a self-selected sample.
Sure.
But it's getting some systematic way of measuring public opinion and communicating public opinion regularly. I think it's going to, that potentially might have just a huge, huge positive
effect. But look how wrong the statistics were about this election.
They weren't that far off, right? They were just systematically wrong state after state, but only about 3%, right? So if you just to rank order states in their vote and rank order the polls, they would get their rank ordering right. They were just kind of systematically off. But if we can get within 3%, I think that might be still better than what the information that the legislators have. So yeah, not perfect, but I think it's better. Yes?
May I pick your mind on a few more things?
Sure. And I'm not out of the answer, but sure, I'll do my best.
The Ohio default system that we all use unless we have charters, local or statewide, doesn't matter which, a voter who changes parties at the primary, who requests the other party's ballot, can be challenged. And there's state law that says how the challenges are, and you can even be required to sign a loyalty oath, that you're sincere, that you really now believe in the new party that you just decided to vote in their primary. Mm. So these are called challenge laws.
Right.
They are not enforced.
Right.
Under the previous Secretary of State, they were enforced. Mm. Under this Secretary of State, there's a directive to the boards of elections, don't do these things.
Right.
Let the voter choose. Should those laws be there, or should somebody work to get them repealed? Are they good?
I mean, it depends on what your definition of good is. I would say, how many people were actually challenged under the previous system? I guess not very many, right?
It was a law that wasn't really enforced.
Right. I think it wasn't enforced because there's almost nobody that really changes parties in the primary, right? If you just look at data in the voter file, because they record the primary you vote in, and a minuscule number of people actually change. Most people don't vote in the primaries at all, right? But the people that vote are, again, the people that are really have very strong opinions and very strong loyalty to their party. I don't think it has a huge impact. Regardless of whether it's a good or bad policy, just changing, I think, would have very little impact on the kind of the actual what happened in the election day.
Okay.
Yeah, sure.
And that is, this is an overall philosophical question. and one may be more important than the other, and I'd like to hear your opinion. Mm-hmm. One purpose is for political party members to choose their candidate to stand to represent their party for that for that office. Okay, the other is to winnow down a field of voter, a field of candidates to a manageable number. Now, what really is the purpose of primary election?
Good question. So I'm not good with philosophical questions. I'm good with data testing. Sure. I mean, historically, we got primary elections because we wanted the voters to pick each party's nominee, right? We didn't want parties to pick their nominees behind closed doors.
Also in the state law.
Right.
Yeah.
But it certainly serves both purposes, and both purposes are important. Mm-hmm. So I'm not sure. I mean, I'm not sure how you weighed it too. I'm not sure. Right. Again, I think reasonable people can disagree about which of those is the most important function. I haven't thought about it carefully enough.
Okay.
I think
that's a good answer.
I know. To the extent that I thought about it, I would kind of go back to this point that I do think party insiders, because they want to win, are probably going to be in the long term kind of the best people, right? I think their interests are going to overlap most with the largest number of voters. Not because they care, but because their goal is to win and keep power. And I think anything that we can do to empower the party leadership is probably going to be better for democracy than anything we can do to weaken party leadership. That's kind of my sense of the research out there. Yes?
So I don't get it. You want elected officials to, before the election or before whatever, to find out the will of the voters? Is that what you said?
I want after the election, right? After the election, as new issues emerge, right? Maybe we have an election and the most important issue is fracking, and then 2 years from now, right, there's a terrorist attack. Now, terrorism is the most important issue. But how do you know what your constituents want? That wasn't the issue that you were debating on during the election. I want ongoing public opinion surveys on whatever the big bills are before the legislature. And then give that information. Yeah, and say, we just did the survey. Here's this bill. We told the voters. We explained to them what the bill is. We asked their opinion. Here's what the constituents in your district think.
And what do you think the participation in that would be? Because people don't appreciate their power. And what do you think that their opinion would be when they change their opinion? Like,
do
they have an opinion?
That's true. And there's a good debate to be had, right, about how much, do you want their opinion to matter more than the opinion of these experts who study the bills and like think carefully about them? And again, I don't have any.
I would be scared they wouldn't have.
Sure.
I mean, I really.
I think that's a really valid concern. I'd say if what you're worried about is polarization. People are generally less intense in their beliefs about policy. So if all you care about is polarization, I think it would have the moderating effect. It could have a variety of other unintended consequences. Like, again.
There goes your good reason.
Right. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Could we just change our form of government?
Even in Brazil, Catherine, for voting, there's You just have to cast the ballot.
Yeah.
You don't have to cast the ballot. The council can spoil the ballot, and the rate of spoiled ballots is fairly high.
But I heard that in this election, people went to vote, and a high number did not vote for the president.
Right.
They both come, the rest of the ballot, but they left it blank.
Yeah, I don't know how. I think I've never.
600,000 in
Ohio.
No.
Over 6,000 right here in Cuyahoga County.
Did not vote for the president.
They just skipped it and went on for.
Well, at least they were engaged enough, because we always hear that the down ballots don't get the attention. That is interesting.
We talked about increasing the influence of party leaders by putting more money into the parties.
Isn't that maybe
contributing in the sense the polarization that you choke off the opportunity of maybe other parties to emerge? You're basically saying a two-party system.
I'm not saying a two-party system. I mean, this would apply to all parties, right? And if by the case, it would still be a two-party system, because
that's what would happen.
Yeah, and a lot of that's electoral incentives in the single-member districts. But, you know, anything that strengthens party leaders is going to strengthen the small parties as well. If the money is flowing right now independently or through super PACs close to the parties, again, that will probably be a good thing, not just for the two parties, but also for the minor parties as well, because it will give them more control over the message, and not let people who claim to speak for the party unless they really do speak for the party. Mm. Yes?
So you're saying that redistricting isn't going to make any difference, is that what you mean?
For what?
Less polarization, better turnout. If we redistrict these gerrymandered districts that we have in Northwest Ohio, you're saying that that's not going to help the election, the voter turnout, because you said the 50-50 districts aren't a whole lot better.
That is true. I would say let me get back to this. So California also had, 2 years before, had a different reform. They have the Independent Redistricting Commission,
mm-hmm.
and I also did a lot of work on that. So what you find is that the commission, although again, very nonpartisan, less than 20% of the districts are competitive. So the problem is not so much gerrymandering. It's
the
geographic sorting. Most suburbs are heavily Republican. Most rural areas are heavily Republican. Most cities are really heavily Democratic. And once you put in the Voting Rights Act requirements, so most majority Latino and Black districts are going to be 80 to 90% Democratic, just because of most minorities vote for Democrats, and the people that live in those areas who are not minorities also vote for Democrats. So I think you're still going to have most elections are going to be uncompetitive, you really have to draw some really crazy districts, like radial districts, like the Illinois Democratic gerrymander, where they take Chicago and they have strips of Chicago going out from the center. And that way you can get competitive districts, but you have to cut across city lines or cut across county lines. And I don't think most of the districting proposals out there, including the one that Ohio did, do that, right? They put a big emphasis on keeping cities and counties together.
Right.
And so there's not going to be that many more competitive districts. There'll be a few more.
The snake on the lake isn't going to make any difference.
You might get one or two out of 16, but most of them are still going to be heavily Democratic and heavily Republican. That'll be my prediction for this next
year. It'll be a more fair distribution.
Yeah, it might be a more fair distribution.
Sure.
Yes.
You know, you never know where fairness is going to come from. I mean, it looks like it's so scary. But there was an article that I'm sure a lot of you read in the paper that 30 cities in Ohio have come together to form a consortium.
Yeah.
And one thing that struck me is that it said that people really, our wonderful rural area, they made sure they had a good modifier there, has to understand that they will not prosper unless jobs in our urban areas prosper. And that needs to be said dynamically. And I was so pleased to see that they have that kind of coming together of 30 of the cities in Ohio formed this consortium. And they're going to lobby,
Doesn't that sound like what we did with regionalism, though?
Pardon me?
Isn't that a spin-off from some of the regionalism stuff that we did before?
Well, I'm not saying that we haven't talked about this kind of thing before, but I'm saying all of a sudden something's kind of coming together.
The mayors are better.
Yeah.
No,
I
might
say.
Be, we might be ranging really, really far from the subject.
I'm coming back to the competitive list part. I just wanted to, you know, it is true, though, that every once in a while, our Congress flips or our state legislature flips. So, you know, it's not like it's totally uncompetitive. I mean,
yeah, I mean, there's big natural waves. Like if you have a huge recession or a huge war, there'll probably be another recession flip.
Really
but it just takes a really big shock, right?
Yeah.
A really big local shock. So it just makes it much harder to make that.
Okay, one more question, and then we're going to wrap it up. Go ahead.
Gerrymandering. When did that, do you have any idea in time where that began? Like when whatever party?
Yeah, it began like in 1789.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. So
they're getting way in the
world.
The word came.
The word is from like 1802 when Governor Gary of Massachusetts.
But there have been a rash of new laws. I mean, that's my impression. I don't know if I'm right, but. Haven't there been like in the last 20 or 30 or 40 years a move to redraw boundaries for voters?
So that happened in the 1960s. Up until the 1960s, there was really no requirement to redistrict every 10 years. So we had huge malapportionment, right? We had districts that followed county lines. So you had somebody representing 500 voters and somebody else representing 500,000.
Okay.
And in the early 1960s, the Supreme Court said, you know, the Constitution requires one man, one vote. So you have to have equal population. That means every 10 years when there's new census data, if areas are growing unequal, you have to redistrict every 10 years. And that became much easier to gerrymander because you know exactly where you control state government, because you know exactly right when the census data comes out. So as long as you have unified control in that year, you can take that data and draw districts that favors you. Before that, it's just politically, right? If you're an incumbent, why would you change your district? You'd keep winning. So there was a lot of built-in inertia against changing districts. So they were very reluctant as an incumbent to redraw the district. But now it has to be done every 10 years, so you might as well take advantage of it to help your attorney.
Thank you.
Great visit.
Thank you.